everybody. Welcome to episode 30 of the Brownie Knits podcast. I'm your host, Gina, aka Brownie Knits. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch this episode. If you're a returning viewer, welcome back. If you're a new viewer, welcome to the podcast. In this episode, I'm going to talk about a few exciting projects that I've finished up, some new things that I have working on the needles, and one project in particular that I'm super excited about that I put together and get to work on in December. So I hope that you will find something that you enjoy in the podcast. And you can always find me on Ravelry on the Brownie Knits group. Come and join us and chat along. And on Instagram as Brownie Knits. You can also find me in Facebook and Craftsy. And I have a Brownie Knits Etsy shop too, where I sell some project bags and all of my patterns on that site too. So let's get straight into it, shall we? First off, so when I went to Rhinebeck, I, you know, went in with a budget and that I had saved for a little over a year. And I didn't know if I was gonna come back with like sweater quantity yarn or just like one prize skein of yarn or whatever. And I ended up letting myself splurge on one skein of Paco Vicuna from Bijou Basin Ranch. And part of my goal when I got home from Rhinebeck was to knit up what I bought as soon as possible because I just loved it all and wanted to use it. So last Friday, I spent the entire day working on these mitts and finished them up that day so that I could have them to wear. And I used the Susie's Reading Mitts, which is a free Ravelry pattern. They're super popular mitts. So here they are. Aren't they gorgeous? They just turned out so well. And I have a little bit of the skein left over. So this much left over. It was a 200-yard skein. I'd say, I mean, I'm not sure, like, it didn't say DK or Sport. It didn't give a gauge on there. But it knitted up kind of like a DK would. So I knitted these on a US 5 needle. I used Magic Loop. I made the smallest size because with them having, behaving more like alpaca would, I didn't want them to, once you stretch that fiber out, it doesn't always have a memory. So I wanted to make the small instead of the medium. Typically, when I've done this pattern in the past, I've knitted it a lot for friends, and I've always done the medium size, but I did the small this time around because of the yarn, and when I did the small, I noticed that the counts didn't quite work out for everything. So when you go to download the pattern in Ravelry, look at the notes that are in the bottom of that pattern display page in Ravelry, because she talks about how to adjust for the stitch count that's off in the small and the large pattern. Other than that, the other thing that I did differently, I wanted the gusset on the thumb to have direction to it. So instead of, it just says make one. So I did a make one right first and then did my stitches and then a make one left so that they would angle out for the thumb gussets. So it worked out really well. I wore them out on Saturday. We're having a really unusually mild and warmer November here. So it was probably in, I think it was around in the 50s Fahrenheit here on Saturday. So I had these on and a scarf and I was comfortable getting in and out of the car when we were doing our errands. We were going ahead and getting, we like to shop for our nieces and nephews Christmas presents before Thanksgiving because the stores are so crazy after and that's just not our cup of tea. So we went and picked up stuff for our three nephews and our niece, and we're actually going to have, my sister-in-law is hosting a foster son over Christmas, and we'll be with him too. So we picked up some items for him as well. That was a challenge because he is from Latvia and we don't believe that he speaks any English. We don't really know, I guess, until he gets here, but trying to find things that would work for a non-English speaker was a little challenging, but we did it, and hopefully he has a few items that he can take back with him and enjoy and get to experience the holiday with us. So, and then, so I finished those up, got to wear those. I'm very happy with them. If you're looking for a great gift knit, these are definitely a wonderful one. Another fast, fun, super fun knit that I finished, this is so popular, is the Baa-ble hat with the little sheepies. I'm gonna put it on even though it'll mess up my hair. And it is just so stinking cute. So happy with it. So when I was at Rhinebeck, this hat was everywhere. It is the Shetland Wool Week free pattern by Donna Smith. And it was absolutely covering the venue at Rhinebeck. Wow, I'm not quite awake this morning. Anyway, so I wanted to make one, and it just so happened that when I got back and was chatting with my two knitter friends, it was really at the top of their list as well. So we had a rare opportunity for us to all get together for a few hours during the week one day, and we decided that we would all cast on our Baa-ble hats. That's the name of the hat pattern, Baa-ble hat, Baa-ble hat. And so I did mine out of, I'm also trying to use up stash yarn a lot. So I knitted mine out of some Swans Island, their natural worsted, Merino worsted that they have, is the brown. The blue is a Cascade 220 Heathers that I had. And the white was an unlabeled leftover. I think it was vintage. It felt like vintage to me. And the black was a little bit of a Madelientosh vintage worsted in a black that I had left over. And then I even had this little fur palm in my stash. So I knitted this up. We cast it on at Christina's house, and I finished it up the very next morning. And if I hadn't been so tired from the day, I probably would have finished it that night. It was so fun and so fast. If you haven't done Fair Isle before, I really didn't think this was too difficult of a Fair Isle pattern. I did do a couple modifications. One, I didn't want the turned up brim in the pattern. You do a really deep brim and then turn it up. I didn't do that on this one. I just preferred it down. So I did half the round count that she recommends for the brim. And then I did not switch to the larger needle for when I went from the rib to the hat. Part of that was because I was knitting away while I was chatting and thinking and didn't really think about, oh, I'm supposed to be changing now. But I also have kind of a small head. It doesn't, like when you look at me, it doesn't look like I have a small head. But like when you measure my head against all my friends, my head is always like at least 2 inches smaller. So, oh well. I wish other things on me were small, but oh well. So I ended up sticking with a size 6, the smaller needle that I used for the brim, I used for the hat, and I think it worked out well. This is not even blocked. So this is Fair Isle, just, you know, how I'd knit it and then put it on. So I'm super happy with it. Super excited to wear it whenever some winter weather, more winter weather, or fallish weather, what we usually have, sets in here. So I just thought it was so cute. Love it. So those were two finished knits. I have another half finished item, and these are my Socks That Rock Fall Frolic. It's the colorway. It's their Socks That Rock on their lightweight. And I have one sock done. This was also a skein of yarn that I bought at Rhinebeck. And it's just so fun to knit. I love how it's striping up. I love the color combinations. I thought that the heel, I did the Fish Lips Kiss heel. turned out really cute. I liked how it striped differently there. I thought sometimes, you know, when you're doing this, I mean, I know I could do it in a different yarn or whatever, but I never do. I just, whatever it, however it comes out when I do my heel. If it stripes differently or pulls or whatever, it doesn't really bother me. But on this one in particular, I thought it was kind of cool. It worked just so perfectly. So I have the second sock is on the needles, and I'm just a little bit above getting ready to work the heel. So I've had a few viewers ask me about a good sock, first sock pattern that I would recommend. And you should go and check out Susan Anderson's sock recipe that she uses. Her blog is so popular. If you just type her name in and knitting, it'll come up. And she has like a sock recipe that she put out for everybody because she knits beautiful socks. And I think that's a great one for first-time knitters to kind of follow along. I've also had people ask me how I pick my color combinations or which colorways for like self-striping yarn I pick. And I don't know. I just, I tend to be drawn to this, a lot of the same colors over and over. But I take more chances with sock yarn, because I figure they're socks, like, you know, versus, you know, a hat or scarf or a sweater that I'm going to have on me where everybody's going to see it. If I don't end up being totally in love with the sock colorway, it's not as big of a deal. Although I do admit, and other knitters I'm sure do this too, I have like three pairs of shoes that I bought mostly because they show off knitted socks. So you can just see like a peek of them. So, you know, I do show those a little bit here and there. Mostly like Mary Jane type shoes. Anyway, so, but then when I'm like kidding, like when I kitted this together, I just played around with yarns that were in my stash, laying them next to each other until I found a combination that really appealed to me. So I don't really know how, I don't know, like sometimes it doesn't work out. So you never know. You just have to kind of take a stab at it and try. So, alrighty. So those were a few finished items. And then, ooh, where did it go? Laid it down here. So I have another couple of five of these hats that I'm getting ready to show you. I've made five of these hats in the last, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks. And this is a new hat pattern that I designed. It's up for sale on all of my sites. So it's on Ravelry, Craftsy, my Etsy shop, and yeah. I think that's everything. And this is a hat that I named after my mom. So it's titled the Leslie Ann hat. Everybody always called my mom by her first and middle name. She was named after her father. So that was one way for them to distinguish. But it just really was her. She wasn't Leslie. She wasn't Les. She was Leslie Ann. And my mom loved hats. And when I was a kid, I can remember going shopping just, you know, just with my mom and my aunt, my great aunts, my grandmother, and we'd just be in like a Kmart or whatever. And they would migrate to the hat section. And as a little girl, I would just be absolutely embarrassed, of course, because all these grown women would be standing around trying on all these different fun hats. And they like to try out different accents, their Southern Indiana version of different accents, while they were trying on these hats. And so they always had so much fun doing that. And now when I go to a store, poor Patrick, my poor husband, I do the same thing. I like try on different hats and things. So, and mom loved to wear the hats that I knitted and crocheted. So this set, I'm going to take off my Baa-ble. And put on one of these. So I designed the pattern to have three sizes. So there's a child size and two adult sizes, and the adult sizes work really well for teenagers too. So this is the adult, small, medium. And so it is a slouchy hat. So you've got this slouch going on back here, but you have a little bill here and a little brim. And then you do this, like, it's a modified rib pattern through here, just using knits and purls. And then you do like a pretty fast stockinette decrease. So if you're an adult, teen or an adult, and you like a slouchy hat, but you don't want too much slouch, the small medium will accommodate that. And because there's such a big rib pattern here, it doesn't really matter if you have a hat size of 19 inches or up to 24 inches. Either of the sizes will really fit you. It's a little bit more about how much of a slouch you want. And there is a video that I linked to. There are demonstration photos in the pattern. And when you buy the pattern, you get a video link to a demonstration to how to do this bill, because the bill is picked up along the rib stitches and then worked down. And there are some, it has like this slight increase on each side. So you increase here, but you also increase with more pickups. And then you finish it off with an I-cord, an applied I-cord bind off. And that keeps it from rolling up, because the bill is in stockinette stitch. If it wasn't in, didn't have the I-cord, it would just roll up. So I thought it was really cute. I thought it turned out pretty well. That's the adult small medium. I'll try on the large, extra large for you so you can see how it has more slouch. Now, like I said, it does have a child size, and my little niece did some modeling for me. She's such a girly girl and loves to model, so it's perfect. Got a pack on me. So in the pattern record in Ravelry and all the other sites, you can see Ella modeling it too, so you can see how it looks on a little girl. And then if you are on Instagram, I took some photos of Christina Wall of A Knitter's Life. She made a hat for me as a test knitter, as did the Yarnienta 247. Thanks, Lisa and Christina, both for being my test knitters for this project. And I regrammed, I did a photo shoot with Christina for a bunch of other stuff, and we took some photos of her in the hat too. So you can see photos up there of her too, and the one that she made is like a brownish color. And she made the large, extra large. And this is the large, extra large too. So you can see it has a lot more slouch to it, but it still fits about the same. And I just think I loved how it worked. And it does cover your ears. The bill is picked up and worked back so that it covers just touching the ears. But it's, you know, deep enough that it covers your ears too. So it'll keep you nice and warm in the winter. I've worn it a couple times when it's been rainy out here, and just rainy in the low 50s, high 40s, and wore it with like a little scarf and a jean jacket, and it's been perfect. So, and you can make it out of anything really. The two that I'm showing here used Swan's Island yarns, but the hats that I have made for my niece, the purple one that is shown in the pattern, was out of Malabrigo Rios, their worsted weight. I think it's washable, I believe, Merino yarn. And I made her one out of Dream and Color Classy. And then I just finished up knitting one for my cousin, who was very close with my mom, and I knitted hers out of Berroco Vintage. So, you know, really, if you look in your stash and you have a skein of worsted weight, and you can get gauge, it's on a 7 and a 9, so it goes pretty fast. And I personally found, and I know Christina commented on it too, that the pattern is pretty addictive, like the body modified rib pattern. Like, I just wanted to keep doing it. So it's a great Christmas knit if you are looking for something fast to knit up. I think it has kind of a different look to it too, a little bit. So there you go. That's my newest pattern, the Leslie Ann hat. So love you, Mom. Okay. And even though in the pattern I say that you need 240 yards for the large, extra large, I did get it out of one ball of vintage, which is 217 yards, so you can chance it. I always add a little bit of yardage to my patterns because people do knit differently, and so I always add about 10%. So, okay, then what else do I have going on? So IU basketball season started, and last year I knitted socks that showed the win-loss record for the team. And this year I decided to just do a cowl. So it's very similar to like the Cracker Jack pattern that's free in Ravelry that indicates win-loss records for baseball seasons. Except for that one, you do like a couple rows, well, depending how long you want it. And like she did a different color for home wins and away wins and home losses and away losses. For basketball, there aren't nearly as many games. So I figured out how many games the Hoosiers would be playing exhibition through. I did one game of the Big Ten tourney and one game of the NCAA tourney. So I didn't make any assumptions beyond that. I took that and figured out my gauge on what I was getting per inch, figured out how many inches I wanted it to be, and then divided that and times it all out to by the number of games. And so I am knitting in red for wins. I'm doing, it's 100 stitches on a size 6 needle. Excuse me. I think I'm getting a little bit of a cough. Notice my throat really hurting starting last night. A little bit of a cold maybe. Hopefully not a cough, but a cold. Anyway, so I've done 100 stitches on a 6 in the round. I'm doing 12 rounds per game, assuming 36 games. So I'm targeting, you know, 60 inches, a little more. And it'll be a closed cowl. So I'll just graph the ends together. Actually, I didn't do a provisional cast on. I was being too lazy. So I'll just whip stitch them together or something. And I'm using, I had a skein of Madelientosh Pashmina in my stash. So I'm using that as my red. And then I had two skeins of Manos Serena in there. It's like a creamish white, natural is the color. So I'm using that for any losses. And I have it stored in my fun little bag that A Knitter's Life made me last year for Christmas because it's the perfect colors. So I have that all stored. And after each game, I knit up my 12 rows and then I'll have that finished hopefully in April. Realistically, maybe March. But that's just the fun little thing to do. I did one for the baseball season a couple years ago for my husband. I did the socks last year for myself, and so I'm just doing that this year. And then I have one other knitting project to show you before I get to the thing I'm super excited to share. Now, this knitting project is the Mystery Knit Along, the Doodler by Stephen West of WestKnits. So if you do not want to see how it looks for clue one, although I don't know how you would have avoided it by now. It's like fills up my Instagram feed. But I am still in clue one. So you're not gonna see clue two or three or four in this video. You would only see clue one. So here it is. And oh, I'm mid row, so you can't, let's see. There you go, a little bit. Maybe try the front side. There you go. So I'm using, there you go. You can kind of see how it works. Getting these little wings and the curvature and the eyelets. It's fun. I have a few more wedges to go. I'm using all stash yarns again. So my main color is this skein of, I believe it is Calypso from Creatively Dyed. I tried to find Creatively Dyed online yesterday. I'm not sure if she's still around. I got it so many years ago at a festival that we have here in Indiana. And it was the first year that I went. I really honestly think it might have been even like 8 years ago. Wow. So it's been sitting in my stash waiting for the exact right project to come out for, right? And it's kind of crazy. So I thought that would be perfect for, you know, because Steven has some really unique designs, and I thought being very colorful would be great with this one. And then the red that I'm using, it did not have a label on it, so I'm pretty sure that it was some Miss Babs that I dyed into this red color. It's a fingering weight as well. And then I have this lovely, lovely orange, and this is a Madelientosh, their sock weight, Tosh sock in the citrus colorway. So that'll be my color C. So hopefully you can sort of see in there a little bit. Yeah. So hopefully that all go to well together. And I've had so much work knitting and crocheting. I have some test projects. I have some patterns that I'm working on that won't even come out until, you know, into next year. But it just takes so long to get some stuff done. So that's why I'm still stuck on Clue 1, even though Clue 2 has already been released. Whoops, I'm throwing my bag around. But it's been great fun. It's so much fun. It's been my reward knitting. So at the end of the day, after I have my other work done, I've been working on my doodler. So it's been a lot of fun to do. Then let's see. Okay, so this project, let me explain how this came about. So I was with Christina and we were having a little bit of a knitting morning. We get together maybe once every 2 weeks or 3 weeks. And we were talking about the opal advent calendars that are out, and they're pretty hard to find. So we're like, you know, probably couldn't get one at this point. And they were talking about different fun things that you can do, just different ideas. We were just having conversation. And around the holidays, if you have lost a loved one or have any kind of distance between, like literally distance, like I'm very far away from a lot of my family. So the holidays, although they're fun and festive, can be kind of difficult when you are missing someone. And so we decided that for myself and Christina and Carol, that we would put together an adult yarn-based advent wreath. Actually, when we first decided to do it, we weren't really sure what it was going to be, if it was just going to be a wreath or if it's going to be in a basket, like what we were going to do. So we decided that one of us would take the odd day numbers and one of us would take the even, and we would take our leftover scraps of fingering weight yarn that we had in our baskets at home, and we would create three matching bags. So for instance, you know, if I had a leftover of a particular skein, I divided that into 20 yards each and put them in three different kits. So myself, Christina, and Carol. And then we were talking about, have you seen the skeins of yarn that have a treat in the middle? So for mine, I actually wrapped the yarn around a treat. And the treat, I don't want to tell you what they are because I don't want to spoil surprises for the girls. And I have a really bad memory sometimes. So by the time I get to my days, I won't even remember what I've put in them. And I've secretly been squirreling away things that I got. Like, you know, sometimes you'll buy something and you get something free. So I've been squirreling stuff away like that for a long time, and it just worked out perfectly that I had items to put in the centers of the yarn balls. And so every day when we open our advent calendar for that day, our advent bag for that day, we are going to do the same kind of concept as my IU cowl. So we're going to cast on a certain number of stitches and knit in the round. And so you knit the round for the yarn for that day, and then by the end of, by the 25th, we'll have a cowl that we can craft together and have to wear. And I think it'll be, I mean, it has the potential to be beautiful or crazy or ugly, I guess, because we did it blind. Like I, you know, just, I try, other than trying not to put like the same color sets too close together within my odd numbers. Other than that, I didn't like limit anything. We didn't use any whites or creams just because that sticks out a little much. But other than that, we just let any colors be in it. So we have no idea how it's going to look. And then I happen to have a bunch of, I mean, a bunch, like 10 embroidery hoops. We have this little store in Indianapolis. It's in the Broad Ripple Village, and it's called Indie Upcycle. And you can take any craft items, supplies that you don't want, and you can donate it to Indie Upcycle, and crafters can come in and you as the shopper say what you will pay for them. So it's a great way for crafters to give and take their crafting supplies. So if I'm, you know, over doing a certain craft, I'll take stuff down and donate to them. And then I'll take a look around and see if there's something that leads itself to a project I'm working on. So I had this stack of embroidery hoops that when I bought them, my husband said, what are you going to do with them? And I said, I have no idea. But when I was shopping, by the way, I was very uncomfortable. I had no idea like what in terms of what to offer for money. So the staff that works there is very good about helping you feel like, you know, you're giving a fair price. So I got all these hoops for very, very inexpensive for what you might pay for like one hoop at the store. And I went out and I found these ribbons to put on the hoops because Christina and I had done a secret Pinterest board where we tagged all these different advent calendar ideas. And so that's kind of how it came into development and what it was going to look like. So here it is. I'm going to lean back so you can see it. So I took a embroidery hoop. This, they have these finished bows at Michael's, and I just wrapped that around. And then I did the odd bags, and the odd ones or the odd day bags, I did these little brown paper packages because I love brown paper packages tied up with string. And I decorated each one with a little like clothespin kind of pin thing, and then a little like sticker of some sort, and tied it on with some jute. And then Christina did these red and white bags that have this beautiful print on them, and we tied those on with like a red and white twiny thread. And so we have them all here from 1 to 25. And I am so excited to hang this up downstairs and then go down there every morning and open up my day and work on my little cowl for that day. So I'm going to Instagram this. So you can follow me as BrownieKnits on Instagram. And every day I'll Instagram a photo of what it looks like when I open it. And then at the end of the day, what it looks like knitted up, or at least that's the goal anyway. And Christina and Carol and I decided on a time of day when we could each Instagram so that we didn't ruin each other's surprises. So they get up a lot earlier than I do. So yeah. I'm so excited about it. And I, you know, there's still time. So if you have some friends and you want to use up some of your sock scraps. Like I said, we did 16 to 20 yards per day in the hopes that that would give us, you know, a decent length cowl. Infinity scarf, cowl, whatever you want to call it. So I was so excited. And Christina, of course, did these like gorgeous day tags with her numbers. And then mine just look like chicken scratch, but that's okay. I thought the combination, even with us not knowing what the other one was really doing, I thought it turned out looking really cute together. So there were all kinds of ideas. If you don't have a hoop, you could do it, like put them in a basket. If you just type in advent wreaths or advent calendars, sorry, I keep saying wreaths, on Pinterest, you'll get so many gorgeous ideas and options that come up. And I'm super excited because I never had an advent calendar growing up. So this is my first one ever. And as a yarnie, I'm so excited that it's involving yarn. So it'll just be a fun way to have a little pick-me-up each day. And I've been storing my knits in this little Fair Isle basket. And I mention it because they're at Michael's right now for like 50% off, and they were so cute. So it's been perfect to like just have next to me each day. And then, just to knit and crochet from and whatever. So I think that's everything. I wanted to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving. I hope you have a wonderful Turkey Day and few days off around it. Hopefully you have a few days off. If not, thank you for working so that everybody else can be out and about. The next time that I podcast, you'll get to see my finish to Brownie Knits 2015 blankets from the BK Blanket Along that we've been doing all year long. That will be the video that also releases block 12, our final block. I can't believe we're already there. I feel like this, having that each month to release, has kind of like given me benchmarks for the year. Oh, this happened between block 11 and 12, that kind of thing. So I will show both of my finished sewn together blocks, block 12, and I'll also be releasing a separate video for blocking and seaming of that pattern. So, all right, I hope you found something that you enjoyed, and please let me see your projects that you're working on and things like that. Share in the Brownie Knits Ravelry group. I'll have a thread open for episode 30 that you can post in, and you can always start your own thread too. So, all right, I will talk to you guys later. Bye-bye, happy knitting and crocheting.